Welcome back, Dr. Abby. We're so excited to have you back to speak about, this pandemic, where it's gone since last winter, and all things mutations and variants, particularly the Delta variant. And I know that in February, we touched base with you after our initial conversation in December about variants. And in our last conversation, if I was a good student, what I learned from you was that variants and strains are not exactly the same thing. All strains are variants, but not all variants are strains. I don't know if I got
That's
that
right. Yeah, you got it.
See? So I learned something, but I will tell you, I'm quite confused by the Delta variant and Gamma and Lambda and whatever else might be out there. And so we thought, why rack our brains and not just go back to our trusted source, which is you? And we are so grateful to have you here today and to speak with us. And so we're going to kick it off if Mary doesn't have anything else that she wants to add.
Yeah, no, and I think in the beginning of August, Tiffany was prepping to send her 5-year-old son to kindergarten, which normally is an exciting time. But this Delta variant and the lack of, just not full acceptance of the vaccine, I think has caused a lot of parents to worry, and especially for those who have children who don't have the option to have a vaccine. So that was another reason that we thought, wow, let's go to our trusted source. And so thank you for taking time this morning.
Of course.
Mary, I think you make a great point. This conversation is not just about gaining community knowledge, but it's a very personal concern. It's driving me very crazy here. What's interesting is our partnership. Mary and I are in two different places. She's in Massachusetts, I'm in Georgia, and they've both handled the vaccine dissemination and information very differently. And it reflects in the numbers of vaccinated persons. So Mary is closer to a rate of 90%, whereas here in Georgia, we're under 40. And I think it makes for a unique conversation when we talk about our community, who is all over the United States and what they're dealing with and how realities are very different from for each individual based on their location. And so we're hoping to get baseline information out for everybody so that they can become agents wherever they are, given their situations and circumstances.
Yeah, no, it totally makes sense.
And so our first question for you is Delta a variant as well as a strain? And what about Lambda and Gamma?
Yeah, when we had talked about this back in February, the question was, there's mutant, there's variant, there's strain, what are these things? And so I was trying to explain what they all are. I will say at this point, there's no way you're going to keep track because everyone is using the terms interchangeably. And they're not the same thing, as we explained before. But in terms of the variants that are happening now, I would say I would totally forget about the strain versus variant name because even people who like their job is literally to name things argue about what makes a strain and what makes a variant, right? And so I think now, and I when you look at the media, even when you look at like different government websites, people are using strain and variant interchangeably. So I would forget about that naming structure. I know I taught it to you. Now, psh, out the window. We're going to roll with the times. And what I would actually focus on is what the WHO labels variants of interest, variants of high consequence, and then variants of concern. So those are different categories that are given to the variants that we talk about, like Delta, Gamma, Lambda. So a variant of interest basically is one that has some mutations that we're like, oh, these mutations can cause it to be more resistant, or this mutation can cause it to be more transmissible. Let's just watch and see if it plays out like that. So those are the variants of interest. Right now, there are a handful of ones you probably never heard of, iota, whatever, and they're just being like monitored out in the ethers, nothing to be worried about. Variants of concern are the ones that we hear about. So Delta, Gamma, and Alpha and Beta, all those are the ones that we've spoken about before. And just to clarify, those names are the new names for the ones that we already knew before. So Beta was the UK, or maybe Alpha was the UK, I can't remember, but those were the variants that we already heard about. But now from numbers, we went to names just to make it a little bit easier. So you might also see those interchangeably at times. But that's, I think, the category that I would focus on. So variants of concern are the ones that we're currently talking about. the way they become concerning is if they show that they're more infectious or they transmit more quickly. Maybe their symptoms they cause are more severe. That's when we start worrying about those. Now, a variant of high consequence, that's like the highest category, that is one that is showing us that not only is it having these properties of maybe being more infectious, but now we're seeing that our treatments aren't working or our vaccines are much less effective than we would plan, or we're not able to locate it or test it with our current diagnostics. That's when something becomes high consequence. There are none right now labeled like that for COVID. None of the COVID variants are considered, have reached the level of high consequence. So right now we are just in a variant of concern. And I think that naming structure is much easier because that helps us realize, do we care about this? Do we not care about this? Like, what's up with this? And that's what we want to know, right? At the end of the day, it doesn't matter what it's called. We need to know if we need to be worried about it. So that's the naming I would focus on.